It is a privilege to be here this morning and bring the word to you, especially after Ken's message last week. Ken brought us to Genesis and showed us the beautiful promises of the Abrahamic covenants, especially the fact that we have now been blessed in Jesus Christ. And this morning I wanted to take another look at the blessings that we have in God and how to respond to them in the correct manner. And so this morning I wanted us to look at what I believe to be one of the sweetest passages. Please open with me to John 6. John 6. What's interesting about John is he stands distinct from the other three Gospels, where they are very similar to one another. John oftentimes will add something additional to a lot of the stories that are in the other Gospels. And because of this, he's often referred to as the spiritual gospel, the spiritual gospel. And this morning is going to be one of those instances following the feeding of the 5,000. So John 6 is obviously a lot to cover in one morning. We're not going to hit everything. There are two signs. There's an I am statement. There's theological declarations on Christ's omniscience, his power, election, eternal security. And so we must be careful this morning and intent, and we must treat this as a survey, or we're going to get lost in all of these beautiful truths that we can find in John 6 this morning. There will be no explanation of Greek, so those of you who do not like Greek, you're welcome. There will be no extended looks at the signs, nor will we dig into God's sovereignty and salvation, nor will we reference many other scriptural passages. And although those are all important, this morning I wanted us to have one purpose, and that is simply that we observe the person of Jesus Christ and our hearts cherish him more. So with that, let's pray, and then we will get started. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this morning, and I thank you for your faithfulness to Southside Bible Church, Lord. I pray that your faithfulness would display itself again this morning as we open up one of the sweetest passages on the person of Jesus Christ. I pray that each and every heart in this room, Lord, would not get caught up in the things that this world has to offer, but would see and behold and cherish the Son of the living God above everything, everything that this life has to offer, Lord. You have given us yourself, Lord, and I pray that your heart, or our hearts, would see that this morning. In your name, amen. All right. Jesus is going through Galilee, and he comes to this place where he has all the men sit down. It says there was 5,000 of them in total, and if it included women and children, it could have been up to 20,000 total people. And you guys all know this story. He feeds them all with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Feeds them all with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. This is amazing. Only God could do this. And the people get it too. And so their response in verse 14 and 15 shows us that. They say, this man is the prophet. He's our Messiah. He is our king. Let's make him our king then. If this guy is our Messiah, we must make him our king. And I think that's the right response to the signs. However, I think it is telling that their response comes immediately after Christ heals them and feeds them. Like many in Jewish culture, the Jews following Christ did not see their spiritual need for God. And so the idea of a Messiah who could meet their physical needs was immensely appealing. Let's make this man our king. In response to this, because it was not the time for Christ to sit physically on the throne of David, he withdraws from the crowds to be alone and be with his Father and pray. And the crowd sees him go up into the mountains, and then they see the disciples without Jesus get into a boat, and they go onto the Sea of Galilee and they cross to Capernaum. But before they can get there, a storm arises. A storm arises so great that they fear for their lives, and as they are on the boat fearing for their lives, they see a person begin to walk towards them on the water. And you guys have heard this before, I would imagine. And John takes a different approach, though. It doesn't talk about many of the other things that we know. Christ walks towards the boat, and he gets into the boat, and immediately the boat is on the shore of Capernaum. This is the second sign in our passage this morning, but what I want us to notice is how quickly John transitions from these signs now into the teachings and the words of Christ. It's as if he's saying the signs are important. I want you to see that he is God because of what he can do, but more than that, I want you to hear the words that he has for your life. I want you to hear what he has to say, because it is in his words where you will find life. So this is our context this morning. This is our introduction. That was for free. That's another stolen joke. All right. John 6, 22 through 35. The next day, the crowd that stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was no other small boat there except one, and that Jesus had not entered with his disciples into the boat, but that his disciples had gone away alone. There came other small boats from Tiberias near to the place where they ate the bread after the Lord had given thanks. And so when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the small boats and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not work for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him the Father God has set his seal." Therefore they said to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent." So they said to him, "What then do you do for a sign, so that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform?" "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread out of heaven to eat." Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread out of heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread out of heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world." And they said to him, "Lord, always give us this bread." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst." I feel like I could just close the Bible and end this message today, and we may get a fair deal out of it. This passage is so sweet to my heart. But there are three things that I want us to take away from this text this morning. The first is this: you cannot come to Christ primarily for your physical needs and your blessings. You cannot come to him primarily for your physical needs and blessings. The next day, the crowd comes back, and they're looking for Jesus. And they may have spent the night, they may have gone home and come back, I'm not sure. But they come back and they're looking for Jesus. And they know he went up in the mountain, so maybe they went up there and looked too, but they couldn't find him. And they saw the disciples the day before cross over to the sea, cross over the Sea of Galilee to Capernaum. But they went without Christ, and so they couldn't figure out where did Christ go. And so they knew where the disciples went, but they did not know where this man who had fed them and healed them, intrigued them so much, had gone. They didn't know about him walking on the water. Obviously, if they did, they wouldn't have come back to the place where they were. And if he had walked to Capernaum that night, they probably would have seen him pass by them. But they probably knew that Capernaum was his base of operations, and so they go over there. They go over to Capernaum looking for Jesus. I think they're either looking for him, or more likely, they're looking for the disciples to ask where Jesus was, because they just couldn't figure out where this guy who had fed them was. And when they get over there, you can imagine their surprise then, because Christ is over there. "How did you get over there?" Which is why their response, "Rabbi, when did you get here? How did you get here?" I think it's interesting, Christ's response. He avoids answering their question. He could have told them, "Oh, I walked on the water." But what would their response have been if he had said that? First off, it would have provoked their original intent to make him king, and it was not time for that. And so he avoids telling them about walking on the water. He could have affirmed to them, "I am your king. I can feed you, I can heal you, and I can command time and space itself." Wow, what a king that would have been. But he avoids that. And as always, as he always does in all of his speakings with the people, he gets right to the heart. He gets right to the heart of the crowd coming after him. Look with me at verse 26. Jesus answered and said to them, "Truly, truly," not just one truly, two. This is important. Listen to this, crowd. "I say to you, you seek me not because you saw signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled." The crowds did not return to hear the teachings of Christ, nor did they return out of belief that he was the Son of God. The crowds returned because they wanted more bread. You wanted full stomachs, Jews. You wanted more physical blessings from Christ, and you knew you could get it from Jesus. They didn't care about God. They cared about their guts. Leon Morris said this, they were moved not by full hearts, but by full bellies. They were moved not by full hearts, but by full bellies. And I think if we're honest with ourselves, some of us here today may be coming to Christ for the same reasons. Some of us in the entirety of our lives is the priority, and I think most of us, at least in part in sin, always stumble into this. We come to Christ primarily because of what we can get out of it. It is probably less common here at Southside where the Word of God is proclaimed and Christ is lifted up week after week, but it is prevalent in a sinful heart and a fallen flesh. We may ask for things like a better job or a girl that loves God and will be a good wife, maybe moral children, maybe the American dream, good friends, wealth, health, lack of suffering, all these things we come to God for. There are so many more. But if we come to God for these primarily, then this is nothing short of the prosperity gospel. It is nothing short of the prosperity gospel. If this is where your heart lies, then you are no better than these crowds with empty bellies. You're no better. To you, I would just say this. You can gain the whole world, health, wealth, and prosperity. And you can accomplish everything you want. God could give you everything your flesh desires, but it is all fading away. And when you die, everything in this life will fade away as well. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world but lose his soul? So I would just plead with you this morning, do not live for the things which perish, but for the things which endure forever. And this is exactly where Christ will take us. And it also brings us to our second point. You cannot come to Christ primarily for physical blessings. And point number two, you cannot come to Christ primarily for spiritual blessings. Some of you may be thinking, what are you talking about, Hobie? We have every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. That doesn't sound like what the Bible says. And so just stick with me. Don't try to figure it out right now. Just listen and give me a chance to make sense of it later on. I think that would be fair because we're going to look at verse 27 now and Christ is going to say something a little weird as well. And he explains it a few verses later. So give me some time as well. Look at me at verse 27. Do not work for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to eternal life. Christ says something very strange there. Is he teaching salvation by works? Work for eternal life. It says it right there. Work for eternal life. It sounds like he's telling us to work for eternal life, and the crowd eats this up. That's not a bread pun. They love it. They love it. Oh, work? We can do something to earn eternal life? Great. Yeah, he's right. If we just get this physical bread from us, if he feeds us again, we'll still die. So tell us, God, tell us, Jesus, how can we have this bread that won't perish? What should we do? What should we do? Verse 28, therefore they said to him, what shall we do that we may work the works of God? They are following along with Christ perfectly. They understood what he was saying. And so Christ's response to them tells us what he really meant. Before I get onto that, the flesh and the unregenerate heart are so prone to working. They are so prone to working, especially if it means that we can receive blessing from God. And the Jews get that. They want to work. They want to have a part in their salvation, in their eternal life. And they realize that. And so now they come to Christ and they ask, what work must we do to have food which endures to eternal life? What must we do? This could even be our sub-point today. And that is this. You cannot work to earn God's blessing. You cannot work to earn God's blessing. Look at Christ's response now in verse 29. Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him who has sent. That you believe in him whom he has sent. Just believe. Just believe. Don't work. Don't work. There is no work that will ever earn you God's favor. Jews, Southside saints, nothing you do will ever earn God's favor. He is just and we are sinful, and so he must punish us, and he has no obligation to ever bless us for us trying to please him. We deserve only his wrath, and that is all. And so Christ is saying, don't work. It'll get you nowhere. Just believe. Just believe in his son and the work that his son has done. At this point, it becomes more and more clear that the Jews, they don't get it. They're just totally offbeat with Christ. They respond to him by saying this in verse 30. "What then do you do for a sign, Jesus, so that we may see and believe you?" This should come across as utterly incomprehensible, blasphemous even. Imagine the disciples sitting there, hearing this crowd come and say, "Jesus, show us a sign." They just had a sign the day before. They have been following Christ and seeing healings. They just had up to 20,000 people fed from 5 loaves of bread. And they ask for a sign. That should sicken you. They don't get it. What sign do they want? What sign do you want, Jews? Verse 31, "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread out of heaven to eat." They're referencing back to the Jews in the wilderness when Moses fed them with manna, and they had it day after day, and they are telling Christ, "Give us bread every day. Give us bread every day, Christ, so that we never go hungry." I gather 2 things from this. The first is that they're still just trying to fill their stomachs. I think they see that Christ is now shifting the conversation where he's not going to give them bread again, and they start to think, well, we got to figure out how to get bread here. We're going to go home hungry if we don't. So they now try to manipulate Christ to give them bread like Moses gave the Jews bread in the wilderness. And 2, I gather that they do see Christ's point that if they get food once, they're going to die. So they need an eternal source of life. And so they start to seek Christ, not just for the physical bread one time, but they start to seek Christ for blessings that they thought had eternal benefits. And this argument by the Jews is just so terrible. It's so weak, and Christ sees right through it. He sees right through their manipulation, and he just starts to pick it apart. I'm a teacher at a school, and I think anyone that's a teacher at a school, even any parents really would know this, is that kids are so prone to try to manipulate you. And I just am amazed and aghast how often students will try to manipulate me, and they think they're tricking me, and they give me the worst arguments for things. I kid you not, about 2 weeks ago, I had a student who told me that his dog ate his homework. I was like, man, that is just like textbook. Like, I thought that was only in the jokes. And then you tell them you don't believe them, and then they try to act like they're telling the truth, and they're like, "Oh, well, he did, but I'll get it done by the end of class today. Is that all right?" Oh, okay, so you didn't do your homework. Thanks, Jimmy, for lying to me. I was talking to a particular pastor's high school daughter just on Friday, and she was telling me, "Oh, I don't lie. Lying is dumb." And then, like 15 minutes later, told me about how she feigned being sick to get out of soccer practice. You're welcome, Kelsey. All right, verse 32. Jesus said to them in response to them asking for a sign, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread out of heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread out of heaven." 3 things from this. First off, this is why their argument's terrible. First off, the bread wasn't even ultimately from Moses. The bread wasn't from Moses, it was from God. So for them to ask that Christ outdo Moses, they are asking for Christ to outdo God. Second thing, and I thought this one was quite funny, is that the Jews in the wilderness, if you recall, they came to hate the manna. They didn't even like it. They started grumbling, "Oh, the fish and the meat that we used to have in Egypt. I wish we could have that again. All we have is this stinking manna. Would someone please save us from this bread?" And then thirdly, and I think this is most important, this is going to be in verse 49. This bread out of heaven does not offer eternal life. I go to verse 49 because Christ kind of reiterates his arguments. Verse 49 says this, "Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died." And so the Jews ate this manna in the wilderness day after day after day and they still died. And so this manna, Jews, isn't even going to save you. If I give you physical bread every day, you will still die. At this point, I would hope most of you, if you're following along with my argument, are asking, what does this have to do with your second point, Hobie? What does this have to do with not coming to Christ primarily for spiritual blessings. Well, two things. I wanted us to see how we are similar to the Jews. We look at them and we think, man, those guys are crazy. There's no way I would do that. But I think we're similar. We are so prone to working to earn God's favor or even sometimes to feel his love. I have a tear running down my face and I'm not even emotional right now. I don't know what's up with that. We are prone to working to earn God's favor and feel his love. And so often we take our eyes off of the God who we love and we start working. Oh God, I'll go do this to feel your love. Oh God, I'll go do this now because I'm a Christian and I want you to be pleased with me. Oh God, I want to go do this so that I can have your favor. One pastor had to ask some people in his church to stop serving. Stop serving if you're not going to be looking at the God whom you're serving and you're just going to be looking at your works to earn God's favor. Also, I think we are prone, in the same way the Jews were, to manipulating God, to getting what we want. Oh God, please just give me health and I'll be happy. I can't take this suffering. If you would just remove this away, I would be so satisfied and content with you. Sometimes we even try to manipulate God with good motives. God, just take this sin away and I will serve you faithfully forever. I had that plea once. God, just take this lust away from my heart and I know I will be able to serve you all the days of my life. But that is manipulation. That is manipulating God to give you what you want. That's how we're similar to the Jews, but I also wanted us to see how we're different from the Jews. We now, in light of the gospel, can see exactly what Christ was saying. He wasn't talking about physical bread that offered eternal physical life, and the Jews, though, were stuck in this rut of thinking physically. They just couldn't get off it. Give us this physical bread, Christ, every day. But Christ is telling us to seek after not the physical food, but the spiritual food, which will endure forever. This is where it links into my second point. And so we as Christians then, professing and genuine, start to pursue the blessings of God, which will endure forever. And there are some. We come to God for all sorts of spiritual, eternal blessings. Justification, removal of God's wrath, eternal life in heaven, all sorts of things, growth in character, there are almost countless. But even chasing after these blessings primarily does not mean that you will inherit eternal life. Does not mean you will inherit eternal life. John Piper said this: many people seem to embrace the good news without embracing God. There is no sure evidence of a new heart just because we want to escape hell. That is a perfectly natural desire. It doesn't take a new heart to want the psychological relief of forgiveness, the removal of God's wrath, or the inheritance of God's world. Even the devils want those things. So hear me out. I am not saying, though, that these blessings, which are available only in the gospel, and there are 10,000 more than what we listed, I am not saying that they are not worthy of our desire or our pursuit. They are. Pursue them. Pursue all of these things however God tells you to. Long for them. But what I am saying is this: not one of these eternal spiritual blessings will be enjoyed by the soul that comes to Christ for them primarily. I would even add one to Piper's list. If you are coming to God primarily to feel his love for you, to know that I am loved by God, if that's primarily why you're coming to God, you will not enjoy any gospel blessing. This is not the bread that endures to eternal life, which Christ is discussing and referencing. Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread out of heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread out of heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down out of heaven and gives life to the world." Then they said to him, "Lord, always give us this bread. We want this bread." "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst." You cannot come to Christ primarily for your physical needs and physical blessings, nor can you come to Christ primarily for your spiritual blessings. You must come to Christ for Christ. He must be your chief desire. He must be your chief joy. There is nothing in this world which can compare, nothing in this world which can satisfy. And God is offering you himself. Come and eat of the bread of life, and you will be satisfied. Why would you settle for anything less? I just have four quick points on this, and then we will close. I am the bread of life. First off, I am. I am. Most of you know where this is coming from. Exodus 3:14, Moses is at the burning bush, about to go free the Israelites from Pharaoh's control. And he tells them, who should I say has sent me? How will the Israelites believe me? And God says, tell them, I am who I am has sent you. I am who I am. And so whenever Christ says, I am, this is nothing less than an emphatic claim to be God. Christ is God, and he is saying, I am God and no one else. Come to me alone for eternal life. Nothing and no one else will ever be able to offer you eternal life but me. So come to me. Secondly, Christ is the bread of life. He is its source. Better yet, you could say he is the bread of eternal life. He is its source. He is life itself. And life itself, 2,000 years ago, entered into humanity and lived the life that you could never live and went up on that cross and suffered the wrath of God and the death that you deserved. And the author of life died. The source of life died. And yet Christ says, I have authority to lay down my life, and I also have authority to pick it back up again and to show his power over sin and death. He raised himself from the dead on the third day, and now he offers that life to you. He offers it to you freely. Third point is on the meaning of eternal life. The meaning of eternal life. When we think of eternal life, we often think of things like heaven. But eternal life does not mean heaven, though that's part of it. It does not mean never ending, though that's part of it. It does not mean the removal of all things negative and the enjoyment of all things God-honoring and good forever, though that is part of it. We are given, straightforward, a definition of eternal life only in one place in the Scriptures, and that is in John 17, verse 3. This is eternal life, that you know the one true God and Jesus Christ whom he has sent, that you know God. This is eternal life, a deep, intimate heart knowledge of God. You can know him personally and have a relationship with him. This is more great. That is bad English. This is better than everything the world has to offer. You can know God, your creator, and enjoy him forever. And fourth thing, verse 35b, he who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst. I always was a little confused when I read that. What does that mean? Why do you switch over to talking about thirsting now, Christ? He who comes to me will never hunger. All right, I got that. You're going to satisfy me forever. You will satisfy me forever. But he who believes in me will never thirst. Why did you switch? And believing are parallel statements in this passage. They are talking not about different things, but the same thing. And so this coming cannot be a physical coming to Christ. There is nothing about coming to Christ physically that will satisfy you or save you. The Jews came to Christ and they were going to die. You can't come up here to the altar. We don't have an altar, but if you came up here, it doesn't save you. So it can't be a physical coming, because it requires belief. See the link there, the belief. The coming must require belief, and so there must be belief in your coming. Secondly, it cannot be merely intellectual belief, because it requires a spiritual coming. It cannot be merely intellectual because it requires a spiritual coming. You cannot just come to Christ and acknowledge all the the gospel in your head. This is not an intellectual belief, but a belief of the heart. The soul that comes to Christ because in his heart he knows and cherishes and wants to make much of God will never hunger or thirst. That is the person that will never hunger. He's not talking about physical hungering or thirsting, as we've just established. He's talking spiritually. You will have sustenance. I will sustain you. But this does not mean, this is important, I want to go over this. This does not mean that there is no suffering in life. This doesn't mean you won't suffer if you come to Christ. In fact, that is promised. You will suffer to be made into the image of his son. Hudson Taylor was a missionary to China. I've been blessed to read about his story. But he suffered something that is tougher than most of us will ever suffer in our lives. He was married to his first wife for 12 years. And on that 12th year, she was giving birth to a son. And that son died in childbirth. And then a few days later, his wife contracted cholera and she died as well. And he was wishing. He was distraught. He was destroyed, as we all would be if we suffered the same circumstances. But in that, he wrote this: "It was in the time of my greatest sorrow that I came to understand why the Lord had made that passage so real to me. Whoever drinks of the water that I give shall never thirst. 20 times a day, perhaps, I felt the heat thirst, the heart thirst coming back. And I cried out to him, 'Lord, you promised me that I would never thirst, and I need to drink from the fountain now.' And whether I called by day or night, quickly he came and satisfied my sorrowing heart. So much so that I often wondered whether my taken loved ones were enjoying more of his presence than I was." Closed off that devotional with his poem, "Lord Jesus, make thyself to me a living bright reality, more present to faith's vision keen than any outward object seen, more dear, more intimately nigh than even the sweetest earthly tie." It is not a promise that you will not suffer, but it is a promise that in your suffering you can come to the bread of life and eat, come to the fountain of living water and drink, and you will be satisfied. So in closing, I just want to ask you, is Jesus Christ enough for you, Southside? Is he really enough? You do yourself no benefit to deceive yourself or lie. Ask yourself, is Christ enough? Could I lose everything that I have gained in this world? Could my family die on the drive home from church this morning? And though I am anguishing, I would be satisfied in Christ. Or do you just want the blessings of heaven, but not its king? I know there are some in the room who stand there because that is where I stood. And I would be amazed if there was not one soul in this room that wanted the blessings of heaven, but not Christ himself. Listen to this quote by J.C. Ryle then, if that is you. "But alas, how little fit for heaven are many who talk of going to heaven when they die while they have not been with Christ. You give him no honor here. You have no communion with him. You do not love him. Alas, what would you do in heaven? What would you do? It would be no place for you. Its joys would be no joys for you. Its happiness, one which you could not enter. Its employments would be a happiness and a burden to your heart. Oh, repent and believe before it is too late." Ken often says this, and I wish to elaborate a little bit more than he does. If I could have heaven, ask yourself, is this true of you? If I could have heaven, and I could have the removal of all earthly stain of sin and the enjoyment of all the pleasures forever, and I could do whatever I wanted and enjoy heaven forever and have my conscience appeased forever, but Christ was not there, it would be hell to me. But if I could have hell and I could descend into the depths of the pit of torment and agony for all of eternity, but I had only Christ, it would be heaven to me. There are really only two responses to this passage that are possible. morning. Turn over to verse 66 with me, please. I know we're skipping a lot. Look at the end of chapter 6. First response. Chapter 6, verse 66, 666, I don't think God could be any clearer. This is the wrong response. Don't come tell me afterward that the verses and chapters weren't there, I know. As a result of this, his teaching, his claim to be God, saying you must come to him alone, many of his disciples withdrew and were not walking with him anymore. This is nothing less than a full-scale rejection of God himself. This is nothing less than a full-scale rejection. I don't want God, and if he won't bless me, I'm out. I'm out. You can make this decision now in your life or later down the road, or you can play with God until the day that you die, but you never find fulfillment in God himself. And you will stand before him on that day of judgment and hear those dreadful, dreadful words, "Depart from me. I never knew you." Oh, how I pray there is not a soul in this room. You seek the blessings of God and you will receive the worst torment of all. You never knew the greatest blessing. But look at the second response, verse 67. So Jesus said to the 12, "You do not want to go away also, do you?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life." There's nowhere else you can go to find eternal life, Southside. And we know this. We've tasted of the bread of life already, and then we go back to the things of the world. Why? But every single soul in this room has been given the chance this morning to have this response, the response of Peter, "Where else will we go?" And so with open hands now, God is offering to you life himself in Christ Jesus. There is nothing that will ever be more satisfying, nothing that will ever last more eternally than knowing the God of the universe who created you and loved you and died for you, and now he wants to be with you and dwell with you forever. You have now been beckoned. Come, taste and see and know that the Lord is good. All who come to me will never hunger, and all who believe in me will never thirst, and all who come to me I will never cast out. Let's pray. Father, one thing I ask, one thing I seek, Lord, that I may dwell in your house all the days of my life, gaze upon your word, meditate in your temple, and worship you at your feet for all of eternity. Lord, there is nothing that this world can offer, and there is nothing besides you, Lord, that will satisfy us for all of eternity. How great that the God of the universe has died to offer himself to us, Lord. This should break our hearts, break our knees in reverence for you, in admiration for you, desire for you, Lord. And yet it doesn't. We cherish you the way we should. We don't value you as we should, Lord, and we keep running back to the things the world has to offer, Lord, and we keep running back to the things that you have to offer as our primary joy rather than you yourself. Lord, we face a very daunting task of going out into the world for the rest of our life and desiring you above all else, Lord. But you are so faithful, and you can draw our hearts to you however you like, and you can satisfy our hearts with you all the days of our life. Lord, you have beckoned us, come and eat of the bread of life. And so I pray now, Lord, we come and eat. We eat of Christ, and we delight in him as our greatest joy. We will be satisfied forever, Lord. And yet sin remains, doesn't it? knowing you perfectly now. We can have such great joy now, but it is nothing compared to what is to come, Lord, where our sin will one day be removed, and we will stand in your presence for all of eternity, and we will know the living God in his fullness, and we will praise and worship you and be delighted in you all the days of our life. Oh, Lord, how I pray that day comes soon, but until it does, Lord, equip your saints by showing them your worth and your value, I pray. Amen.